all you Joygasmers out there, and welcome back to Joygasm, a video game and movie podcast. I'm Russ, he is Steve, and we're so glad that the Baba Yaga has visited us again in episode 312 today, March 23rd, 2023. We're going to be getting right into our topic of the day, which is John Wick. Chapter 4, movie review. So there's no reason to skip ahead. But just to be certain, make sure you serve that subscribe button and be of service to that notification bell. That way you will not miss a single solitary episode of Joygasm. Drops once a week. Each week. Steve, it is always a good day. Nay, a good week. Even a good month, dare I say a good year, when...
Good night.
Oh, good night as well. When John Wick movies get released.
This is true, Rens.
I, as you know, am a huge fan of the John Wick franchise ever since the first film came out. I believe you have also been quite the big fan of John Wick as well.
Indeed.
Indeed, indeed. And so here we are with John Wick Chapter 4. You know what's interesting is the first John Wick film came out in 2014.
It's a while ago.
So it's literally been almost 10 years worth of John Wick goodness.
And you can definitely tell Keanu has gotten a bit older and a bit slower.
A little bit.
But he still brings it, Russ.
He definitely does. He definitely brings it. And yeah, there is something very endearing about when you watch him in this film, because he's slowing down a little bit because obviously, like you said, he's a bit older. He's not as spry as he was 9+ years ago, you know, and that's totally understandable. But you know what? I don't care. Like I
don't care either.
I think that this film,
you can't like John Wick. If they go, John Wick 5, and then they recast John
Wick, no,
it ain't gonna fly.
No. I was gonna say I'm Jack Steve.
I'm Jack to the tits. Can they cut glass, Russ?
Oh, yes, they can. Very much so after seeing this film. What I also think is crazy too is I did not realize that this film is almost 3 hours long.
Yeah, I knew that going in, Russ.
You did.
Having to check the time way beforehand. When I was checking the dates of its release, I was like, is that right?
Uh-huh.
That can't be right. Well, it's right. So I went in there thinking like, okay, this is going to be pretty long. And it was a bit long.
It was a bit long.
Yeah.
It was a bit long, but it was worth it.
And it was worth it, Rod.
I was reading about how actually the first kind of final candidate of the film was well over 3 hours. I can't remember like what
45 minutes they cut out.
Was that what it was?
Yes.
I mean,
and I want to watch it.
I was going to say, like, I sincerely hope that they release some kind of director's cut where they put the 45 minutes back in, because I'm all about that. I want to see it. Yeah. I want to watch as much John Wick as humanly possible.
Yeah.
And what I think is very impressive too is the fact that this is an action film. Mm-hmm. This is not some big drama that has all kinds of complicated moving parts and that sort of thing. From a storytelling perspective, this is an action movie. Like, we go to see this because we want to see the gun foo, right? Like, we love ourselves some gun foo, and we love ourselves some Keanu Reeves. So I'm very impressed that they basically released, I mean, I think the final film runtime was like 2 hours and 47 minutes, I want to say, something like that.
About that.
I can't recall another action film being that long.
Yeah, Return of the King. Nah, it wasn't really action.
That's
not an action.
That's a drama. That's a fantasy drama.
Fantasy drama, yeah. But was Godzilla that long? Because I remember Godzilla being really long.
Yeah, I don't remember if Godzilla was almost 3 hours long or not. And Godzilla, like the way they approached that movie was more of a slow burn. I'm assuming you're talking about the more recent versions. Yeah,
slow enough and I went to sleep.
Yeah. Well, and I think that was kind of their approach to the film was like they wanted to have this like build up, right? They wanted like a slow burn before like finally it was like the big reveal. So that wasn't like nonstop action like John Wick was.
No.
Ladies and gentlemen, there is a metric ton to love about this movie. And that's, I don't say that lightly as a John Wick fan, just because I think that like part of the challenge for the cast and crew is how do they continue setting the bar with each film? And each film has its own persona to it, if you will. Like it's a continuation, obviously, of the story, but I do think that they are always trying to figure out, okay, how can we up the ante? How do you know, the last one we did this and that. Okay. And this one, how are we going to do something that's even more creative or more unexpected, more cool? And they did it.
Which is very difficult to do in your fourth film.
Oh,
I mean, it's hard enough to do in a trilogy, let alone the fourth one.
I do think part of the creative opportunity that they have.
Yeah.
Is because they're based, their films are based off of like martial arts and different types of weapon play. Yeah, weapon combat, that sort of thing. It does like stir the mind in terms of like, okay, how can we, like, what can we do? Like, if we had like a bunch of knives, like, what kind of scenarios could we cook up? If we had like certain types of weaponry, what could we cook up? And like, oh, by the way, how could the camera angles like also be simpatico with like what kind of combat you see on screen and that sort of thing. So it's really a recipe for success because you could keep going in perpetuity, like just over and over and over again of having these films and having each one be fresh and cool from that perspective.
True, but you can't overdo it.
No.
At some point. That's actually one of the small things I started to pick up on where like the body count in this movie was so high and I liked it.
So awesome.
I liked it, but at some point towards the end, I started to feel numb towards it. Because it was so much. And I thought, okay, you know, in every John Wick, there's a very long sequence of gunplay, fighting, executions, if you will.
Yeah.
And so at some point I felt like a bit desensitized is a bit too strong of a word, but I didn't feel like they were as special, you know, because they're always going through, you know, the same kind of fighting sequences, the same sort of moves, same shooting. And there wasn't enough like special sequences in every fight scene that would separate it necessarily from like the third installment and the second installment.
Uh-huh.
Did you pick up on that? Or did you feel the same way? I'm not talking like it's going to ruin the film. I'm just taking it apart just on the fight sequences.
I would say in terms of the fight sequences, so, okay, we have essentially almost a 3-hour long movie. So you're filling that time space. I mean, like most action movies, like when you see fighting and that sort of thing, I would say on average is about an hour and a half.
Sure.
So they basically doubled that amount of screen time, which I am so thankful for because I just had a good time with it. And I know what you're talking about because John Wick chapters 1, 2, and 3, because those films were shorter, there was more of an emphasis on unique combat situations and unique assassin character types, right? You still had that in this film, but I think they were wanting to convey this sense of how it was like John Wick versus the world almost, right? Like he's been on the run for three of the four chapters, you know? So he's having to, I guess technically two out of the four chapters, but still at the same time, this was kind of like the piece de resistance, you know, like it was him having to like finally like understanding like a possible way out of this whole thing that he's been at odds with, that he's had conflict with. And so they're throwing everything, including the kitchen sink, at John Wick to try and stop him, and seeing just how much he was having to go through. I think that there was a level of intention there in terms of making the viewers perhaps feel a little desensitized in order to relate to John Wick, because John Wick's character is an assassin. He's a professional assassin. Right. His whole life, that's his gig. That's his thing. He's not, I mean, like, he, on the one hand, he can be empathetic to certain characters. He has friends in this world, but at the same time, he's a cold-blooded killer. Like, he doesn't have any kind of real afterthought shock about how many people he's murdered. So I think, in a way, I think that was kind of their subtle exercise of having us just kind of get used to, like, all these villains being dispatched. At the same time, though, I do agree with you in the sense that these are like extreme nitpicks.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely.
But in terms of the different fighting scenarios, maybe having one or two other type of very unique type of assassins that are trying to take him out, because it, you know, it did kind of at one point toward the end kind of turn into like you just had anybody who was a contract killer trying to take him out who clearly could not best John Wick. They were not at the same level as John Wick or close to it or whatever, but it was because of the contract, right? Sure. You have $40 million contract. Right. Anybody who's in that world is going to be like, I'm going to try, you know? and much to their dismay, they are no longer.
Demise.
Yeah.
Dismay and demise.
At the same time, though, the cast that they had in this movie, you had so many awesome characters.
Yeah.
And that's one of the many strengths of the John Wick franchise, is that they not only maintain the existing cast, but they build additional characters on top of that existing base. And so you get more and more of this world fleshed out. And we, as the viewers, benefit from that immensely, because, you know, like you see Winston and the King, you know, who are basically turning into these elder figures for John Wick, you know, offering him
old friends.
Yeah. Offering him different types of advice and like how to maneuver and how to do things. And it's always a pleasure seeing both of those gentlemen on screen. I love how they don't just have this approach of one and done. We're like, okay, yeah, we use this actor now. We're going to toss that one and we're going to bring another one. No, like you have this past, this history going on.
I want to bring something up, Russ.
Well, are you going to derail what it is I'm about to talk about?
Okay, Steve? I'll hold off, but it has something to do with what you're talking about. Go ahead. Finish your thought. Please finish your thought.
Okay. Thank you, Steve. Thank you. So what I was going to say is that in terms of the new characters that are being introduced, all of them were fantastic. You know, you have Kane, who is this amazing assassin as well, who's on John Wick's level. Mm. You have you have the new Marquis, who's the French guy, who's like, by the way, did you know that that actor is the same actor who plays the clown in It?
No.
Yes. I'm pretty sure, I can't remember his first name, but his last name is Skarsgård. I was looking at him. I'm like, there is something about his face. I'm pretty sure.
Well, I never saw It, Russ, so.
Well, I didn't either. I never saw it, but like I mean, the trailers were everywhere. It was like this like huge blitzkrieg of marketing when that film came out, and so that, you know, they constantly are showing his face everywhere.
So you're for sure he's the same dude?
I'm pretty sure. Like, I think, I can't, like I said, I can't remember his first name, but his last name I know is Skarsgård. But I was looking at him, I'm like, I think that's the guy from the It movie. So excited, almost choked on my spit. While you're confirming, well, here, you're probably
gonna say. Wait, yeah, you're right.
Yeah?
Yep.
That's right. Which, again, is, it makes for a juicy villain, right? Like, you have someone who's like that, and all of a sudden, he's in this other role, did a marvelous job as the villain, and then you have the tracker, who was the guy with the dog, and that was interesting, and they all had their own kind of motives. You had... We got to go to Osaka and like check out the Japanese continental. And one of our personal favorite actors was like the manager of the Osaka.
Hiroyuki
I have to look at his name because I have trouble pronouncing it. It's Hiroyuki Sanada.
Sanada.
Yeah.
I was going to say Sandada. I'm like,
yeah, yeah.
Zoe Sandada.
I have the list of actors in front of my screen just because some of them, like, I just don't want to, I'm trying my best not to butcher their names. But, you know, you also have the Harbinger, which is, again, another class within the overall underworld of assassins and the High Table. I just, and you know, I'll get to that in a minute, but like, so you have that, you have the daughter of the manager of Osaka. Sure. She's awesome. I mean, like you go through all these different characters and I didn't feel at all like, oh, that character didn't get enough screen time or, oh, I didn't bond with that character or whatever. Like everything worked flawlessly. And I mean, another huge character was, I don't remember his name, but he was he like the brother of the woman who was running the tribe, the Russian tribe that John Wick was trying to get a part of. And she says, she said, kill my brother, right?
I don't think it was her. Or
cousin? I can't remember like what his relation was with them, but like, you know, she said, basically you have to go kill him, bring back proof that you did. And then we'll let you back into
Berlin.
Was it Berlin?
In Berlin,
yeah. Yeah. Let me tell you, that guy was awesome. Like, I've never seen this guy before. I don't know who he was. He had, I mean, and they all had great screen presence, but he was such a delicious villain. Like, he was almost like this roided out version of the Penguin from the Batman world in a way.
Yeah. Martial arts and stuff.
Yes! And again, like that's part of like the unexpected joy of this film is like, you know, you see this guy who's heavy set. He's a big dude, right? He's behind, you're thinking, okay, he's kind of like this gluttonous slug of a crime boss or whatever, you know. He looks awesome. His suit's just totally loud and like he's got the three or four gold teeth off to the side and he's playing with
gold
cards.
Crown, yeah, or something.
Yeah. Like. And
grill.
When things happen and you actually see John Wick fight him, he can hold his own.
Yeah.
And he is surprisingly nimble for like his body type and his size, which was great. I was like, oh, this guy's a threat. Like this guy's a slippery pig, ain't he? So anyway, there are so many fantastically created characters throughout this that once again, it takes what's already amazing and continues to expand upon that and build upon that. And all of the actors, you can tell the actors are having fun.
They are having fun. Yeah. So can I jump in now? Yes. Are you done?
Please.
Okay. I just want to make sure. So yes, for the great majority, I agree.
Are you going to be a negative Nancy?
I'm not going to dump on the
Are cast. You going to be a Debbie Downer, Steve?
I didn't feel Mr. Nobody necessarily had to be a part of the story.
Oh.
He didn't necessarily take away anything. He just didn't add anything to me. And so a lot of the, like his screen time was like, you're not necessarily doing anything to the story. It was more so like, okay, he's here because we're going to do a bunch of spinoffs from John Wick later on. And so we want to give you why introduce a new character, give him, you know, some screen time and then just get rid of him. Like, I think he's there for like the spinoffs they're doing. You know, they're doing a couple spinoffs, right?
Yeah. I don't know if that character in particular is part of it or not.
Right. And then I felt that, like the whole dog thing was done last
with Halle Berry.
So like the whole thing again, I'm like, okay, fine, but it's nothing new. It's nothing cool. And I kind of got tired of like, nuts, and then bites the guy. I'm like, okay, we saw that like last time, you know.
There is a challenge to that. I did think about that, how like, you know, because they did such a great job. I believe it was John Wick 3.
John Wick chapter 3.
You know, Halle Berry, also fantastic addition to the cast. And the fact that she had two, not just one attack dog, she had two attack dogs. Very unique, very cool. So yeah, there is a bit of a challenge, I think, in terms of them revisiting the fact that you have another assassin that has a canine.
But here's the thing. So in chapter two, you had, I forgot the guy's name. Actor was Common, was his stage name. Common, who plays this guy who is the bodyguard or the protector of the sister of the high table guy who he wanted her spot at the table. John Wick had to kill her.
Yeah.
And he was protecting her. And then, so they had a little bout, right?
Yeah.
So there's a scene where they're at the bar at the Continental, mm-hmm. and he's like, John, I'm like, I'll buy your drink. He'll consider it a professional courtesy.
Right, right.
And then later on in the movie, they have this big fight in the subway, and John stabs him with his own knife right in his like aorta or something. Yeah. And he goes, you pull the knife out and you're going to bleed out.
Yeah.
But if you keep it in, and he's basically saying, don't come after me. I could kill you now if I wanted to.
Yeah.
Don't come after me. And the door's closed and the guy doesn't die. He like looks like straight in the camera, just kind of smiles, like, and then the door is closed.
I don't remember him smiling, but
he smiled. He definitely smiled a little bit. My wife and I watched all three movies,
uh-huh.
and they're awesome. Like the John Wick series, you can watch back to back to back.
Yeah,
and they're even better than spacing them out, because I remember like watching the third one and I thought, it's kind of okay. And I still kind of feel like it was probably lackluster compared to one and two, mm-hmm. but watching them back to back to back, I enjoyed it more the second time I watched it in the series versus like, okay, we've watched chapter two, months go by, you know, a year or so. And then we watch chapter three. Mm-hmm. Anyway, that's just side note. Anyhow,
you're digressing big time.
Big time. So I wanted that assassin that got stabbed to come back in this one.
Mm.
And I was thinking it would be better if he was there and he came out of nowhere versus Mr. Nobody with the dog. I thought that would have been cooler, and the fan base probably would have yelled a bunch more in the theater.
That's true. I mean, I think that's a good point. And I think too, like the purpose of the tracker was to kind of give a different perspective to the idea of a pressure cooker, right? So you have John Wick, who's pursuing the high table. He's wanting to get out, and so he's going on this rampage. But then you have this other assassin who part of his bag is he's really good at not just like head rushing in, assaulting and that sort of thing. But he, you could tell he's very methodical.
Sure.
He has like his diary or his journal where like, you could tell he's been tracking and making different sketches and different types of notes along the way, that sort of thing. And then of course he has his dog, which is, you know, it's very much in line with like a tracker class. And so the notion that John Wick has not only like your onslaught of assassins trying to take him out, but you have someone like this as well. It provides a bit more, like, I think, and this kind of goes back to one of the points that you made earlier. Hmm. I do think that a film like this runs the risk of the assassins themselves kind of almost turning into, why'd you stick your tongue out of me?
I didn't. I had a gurgle
of
a burp that I was trying to hold back instead of belching in the microphone.
You completely railroaded my thought process. I was like,
my bad, Ross. That's why I was making it obviously.
Gotcha.
Stupid.
Gotcha, Steve. Where was I, Steve? Were you listening? Probably not. We're talking about the tracker. Oh,
the tracker. Yes. He's making notes in his diary.
Yeah. So what I was going to say is that the film runs the risk of having all these like kind of like nameless, hapless assassins almost be like stormtroopers in a way, right? Where like, if you watch a Star Wars film and you have this huge army of stormtroopers coming toward a Jedi or something, and you don't know their names, you don't know like what makes them unique. You just know they're basically lightsaber fodder. And I think that is one of the risks that I think that the creators of this film recognize, could identify and say, okay, because we are going to have so many assassins coming out, and we'll have a 10-hour movie if we actually like take the time to like really flesh out each one. How do we counterbalance that? And I think that's one of the reasons why they had the tracker, was that we got to see, hey, here's a guy who, you know, he's one among many assassins who are interested in the big payday. And so we get to actually kind of follow his trek through this whole thing. Not only that, but there are very interesting engagements that he has with the Marquis. You know, that whole scene where he comes in and introduces himself, basically Mr. Nobody, that sort of thing. And I love his name too. I love how every villain that he comes in contact with, they have a different type of response to his name. I thought that was fresh. But also too, that scene where you know, he's basically playing hardball with the Marquis, and the Marquis like stabs his hand. Like, that was a brutal scene. Like, you're just like, whoa. Like, it not only helped to flesh out the Marquis's personality more and just how diabolical he is, but also you got to see how this assassin also, like, he's not just a one-dimensional, like, I want to kill John Wick, how much? You know, like there was a lot more to his character. The final point I will say is, and this is one of the highlights for me, most of the John Wick films that we have come across, you see these fleeting instances where he does in fact have friends, or maybe these allies, if you will, right? But they're very like compartmentalized. Like, there's like one ally here and they kind of help John Wick with this part of his journey, or they're over here, like you have a doctor and he'll kind of dress his wound or something. And so you get little inklings of that. This is the first time where you see three very adept assassins all working together, all having mutual respect for each other to go up against the system. And that was I keep saying fresh because it is like you look at it and you're just like, that is awesome. That is so cool because there's this mutual understanding. There's this mutual unsaid respect. And there are these moments like for instance, like John Wick and the others as well. If you notice, their speech patterns are very simple. They get, they're very to the point and Jonathan, with as few words as possible.
Winston.
Yeah. And the reason for that is because as assassins, if that's your lifestyle, if that's your profession, you know that if you say the wrong word, even if it wasn't your intention, the way that your words are interpreted could mean the difference between life and death. And so that is fantastic to see how, again, it could be like one or two word phrases or something like that. And again, I don't know. It adds to the pressure. It adds to the seriousness, the weight or gravitas of every one of those encounters. I just love that because it's not, you don't have someone. I would say maybe the Marquis, kind of the main villain likes to do some monologuing through the films. And that's perfectly fine. But the people that are in the trenches, so to speak, it's their form of business speak.
Right. Oh, what was that line? I'm trying to think of other stuff in the Keanu Reeves said, but I don't really care because you know, you're not in the movie to watch a bunch of monologuing. You're in the movie to watch a lot of action. You know who else was kind of missing was at the end of chapter three. So what happened is, so I was trying to remember what I watched for, because it was like January when I watched it. Anyhow, so you had the adjudicator and she was pretty upset over Winston letting John cap somebody in the Continental.
Right.
And then the armies came and
it's like their version of special forces.
Pretty much like their SWAT team.
Yeah.
And so John and I forgot his name. It starts with a C, his character name. The hotel, you know, basically the
concierge.
The concierge, yeah, but his name starts with a C. It's like, anyway.
I can look it up.
So they both hold their own against the swarm.
It's like Charon, C-H-A-R-O-N. Yeah, exactly,
yeah.
Charon?
Charon, like yeah. So they hold their own. At the end, Winston caps John, but he does so knowing that this is going to hurt, but John is definitely going to live through this and come back. And at the very, very end, you see Lawrence Fishburne's character saying, John, are you mad?
Yeah.
Because I'm pissed off. And then John goes, yeah. And then
the only way Keanu Reeves can do it. Yeah.
Then Lawrence Fishburne, the only thing we see him do is like just bring him a suit. And I was kind of hoping his character would be more involved in this movie.
I do think, well, so he's always... kind of, you know, he's making it very well known that he's the underground king, right?
Sure.
So he's the big boss man. He has his underlings that basically like part of his character's unique strength is that he has this entire network of underlings that can do all of his bidding for him. He doesn't have to go out and be, you know, this person who actually gets his hands personally dirty. You know, he's much more of a, kind of a conduit, if you will, where like, you know, he's able to, well, like when we first get introduced to his character, you know, you see him throwing out pigeons that have messages and, you know, he's not a stakeholder, but he's kind of like one of those like middlemen kind of people who are like he has made his empire based on being the central hub of communications and getting the goods and that sort of thing. Not to mention the fact, I mean, Lawrence, you know, he's old.
Yeah, I just figured, you know, the way they left it at the end, he would have more of an involvement.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true. I mean, it would have been interesting to see like what they could have done in terms of having his character be more directly involved. But I also think too, I think part of the seriousness of the situation in the film is that the High Table is, historically speaking, you just can't trifle with them, otherwise they will obliterate you. And like we saw, for instance, in this film, the New York Continental got blown up. I mean, like that there's just no way that someone of that character stature as the Underground King could ever take out you know, the High Table. Not to mention the fact that he's a survivor, right?
Sure.
He wants to, by proxy, have John Wick take his best stab at taking out the High Table, because if he fails, then at least there's like, you know, the whole like 6 degrees of separation kind of thing, where if the High Table were to come to him, he'd be like, hey, I've been minding my own business over here. Yeah, I wasn't doing anything, you know? And so again, it's that survivor instinct that he has. And not to mention the fact that, like, you know, once again, we all want to see John Wick be the Baba Yaga.
Of course. Let me ask you this though. Did I miss something towards the end?
Towards the end.
When they're taking the little boat, not very nice boat, by the way. Those are expensive boats. But they're taking the underground trolley, if you will, water trolley.
Yes.
And Winston's there, the Underground King or whatever, you know, he calls him, whatever.
He calls him, it was the king, yeah.
Is there, and of course, Baba Yaga. And so they drop John off. They drop him off. And that was with the whole headstone speech. And then they got him mosey on their way. But they drop him off in like the middle of Paris. Mm-hmm. And then they go towards the spot there's going to be the duel. Why did they not just all get off at the same spot? Like, why have John get off here and Winston get off here?
Well, again, I think...
So did I miss something, Russell?
No, I think the reason for that is because, once again, John Wick is constantly being hunted just because he has a date with like this, you know, very old school way of challenging the Marquis. Doesn't mean that there are all these other assassins trying to take him out. I would do the same thing. If I'm Winston, I'm this elderly man. You know, I don't want to be walking right shoulder to shoulder with John Wick and like, I don't know, catch a bullet or a knife or a foot to the face. It's like, yeah, no. I'll meet you there because I know that I don't have a mark on myself.
It's probably, I was thinking about that, but then I thought, did I miss something else? Because why don't they just show up? But that makes, I remember thinking that too.
I want to pivot from what we're talking about over to some of the actual cinematography and camera work of this.
Oh, freaking A.
Golly. John Wick has always been really, really fun to look at, visually speaking. The cinematography in every one of the films has been just a feast for the eyes. Really, really cool. The locales that they use is also one of the series strengths, where they're able to go to these gorgeous vistas, whether it's in New York or it's in Europe somewhere. This time we got to actually go to Japan. Like, there is so... Really, you know, I found myself thinking in the theater, John Wick, in a way, is the American version of James Bond almost. Only he's not a spy. He's not interested in bedding tons and tons of women. He's only, you know, he's the loving husband. He's grieving the loss of his wife. So, there are very distinct differences. But in terms of the combat... And what, you know, his martial arts knowledge and him knowing these other assassins, you know, and James Bond, it was always like James would run into these other spies from other countries, right? John Wick runs into assassins from other countries. It's like that very similar premise. But I love that in terms of being able to go to all of these different locations. And I think in this film, it was like New York, Berlin, Paris, Japan. I think there were like 4 major spots that they went to. And so that was fantastic. I got to say, one of my absolute favorite moments of the film was toward the end where it was the top down view where you saw John Wick laying waste.
The dragon breath.
Oh, but like, I mean, it was the coolest thing having it top down where like the camera was just slowly panning and rotating from room to room and seeing how John Wick is doing his thing. And it wasn't just gunplay, but like all these different moves he was doing. I was just as thrilled being that far away from the action as I am when it, like the camera's up close and personal. So original. You got to not only take in like how like the room, like the set decorations and interior design of every room was so cool, right. But also you got to see John Wick doing his thing. And like, you know, you mentioned there is that special gun that he took from one of the criminals. Yeah, it was the ammo that was like this, like almost like a fireball.
It's like incendiary round kind of thing.
Jeez. Like,
so
I mean,
cool. Freaking A. Oh my gosh.
Go ahead, Steve. What are your thoughts about that scene?
Oh, no, it was I was going to add to that whole litany of cool sequences, but the Berlin scene with the club and the lights, which was done. However, this time it had like that falling water, which light dancing on water anywhere is going to provide a different kind of effect, but it was so centered.
Yeah.
And I mean, I can't wait to watch this movie in 4K.
Yes.
It's going to look amazing. Off the wall. I mean, the movie deserves so many awards.
Yeah.
And we're just at the end of March. Like this sets the bar so high on so many levels. I mean, we were talking about that, just the cinematography after the movie, about how beautiful it was done. And I mean, that part alone was so rewarding. It was beautiful. It had like the cinematic stuff of a movie, but it also had the feeling of a game in a way, like especially that top-down view.
Yeah.
Man.
But it wasn't cheesy at all. It wasn't like, oh, this reminds me of a video game. It's so taking cool. away. No, right. It added to the whole thing.
Right.
Yeah. No. I was grinning ear to ear when I was. I mean, I was smiling through a lot of the film, but like that scene in particular, I was like, man, they are just rolling with it. They have their A game. They're having fun with this.
Yeah.
And one of the little cherry on top things was that if you noticed. And this kind of started happening when John Wick was fighting whoever that relative was of the Berlin people, but like, you know, the big heavyset dude.
Sure.
The original theme song of John Wick from the prior movies came back.
That's what I thought. Yeah, I thought that was that song. It was that Crystal Method, I think it was.
Crystal Method. I don't know if it was that, or maybe it was. I think Tyler Bates is the composer of the music of the John Wick, at least for this film. I don't know if he was in the previous John Wick movies, but that kind of wow.
Yeah, I gotta look it up. Yeah.
I mean, you started getting hints of that right around the time that he was fighting the heavyset guy. And then like when you have like the top down camera view, it was in full force. I mean, you hear it and literally it's like it jives so well with John Wick being in the zone. He's like he's in his personal zone of doing what he does best. And it's literally like when he's not in like these moments of struggle where you're like, ooh, gosh, he's kind of in a pickle. But more like he is just dealing out the business. And you hear that song, and I got goosebumps in my arms. I was just like, oh, this is so, gosh, this is executed so well. No pun intended.
I have a story for you. Just real quick. Digress. So we're in the theater. Mm-hmm. And we're loving everything we're watching. And like my heart's good. Yes, it's so good. And I'm like fidgeting, but just because I'm so into it. There's the seats in the theater, the ones that recline, there's a button. You know there's a heat warmer? There's seat warmer?
No.
There's like a seat warmer.
They're
and
getting
I,
pretty fancy in these theaters
and
these
I
days.
I hit it with my leg or my hand or something while I was like, yeah, not cool, not cool. And so the seat starts warming up and my heart's already going and I start sweating. I'm like, man, it's hot in here. Oh my gosh, like this is so cool. But I thought, my goodness, is it just me? I didn't realize that till the end of the show. Like, I'm the only one just dripping.
Yeah, pouring sweat.
I was like, man, you're really into that.
Apparently was. Oh, wait a minute. Was that setting on or off? It just added to your overall experience.
Man,
you run out there and drenched in sweat. People are like, man, what movie did you see? John Wick Chapter 4. Yeah.
Oh, man.
Like I have so many different scenes going through my head that were so cool. I do think Yes. So let's talk about Donnie Yen.
Yeah.
Because I personally am not too familiar with the previous films.
I am.
I had a feeling you probably had seen some of his other stuff.
Yes.
Has he been around for a while?
Yes. He is a martial artist, mostly doing like Chinese stories, martial artists. Like if he's IP man or Ip man.
Okay.
So if you watch, there's like four movies of that. I mean, the guy is like a kung fu master. So yeah. He knows. Even like there's a interview with Keanu Reeves, and he's giving credit to Hiro and Donnie, mm-hmm. saying like these guys are actual martial artists. He goes, I know martial arts for the screen, for Hollywood, but these guys are actual martial artists. And my wife was going nuts because she's seen all his movies. Oh, you know what else was he was in? He was in Rogue One. I'm with the Force, and the Force is with me.
I didn't realize that.
That he was with.
That is him.
Yeah, he was there too.
And he played a blind person there too.
That's right.
Is that like his thing? Like, does he like playing characters that are blind?
Maybe he's just good at it. I don't know. But he's not blind, and he's not blind in IP Man. So, or Ip Man.
That was so we're talking about his character Kane, right?
Kane, yeah.
Again, the name is great because he has a cane because he's blind. Another aspect to it that I think is really interesting is the fact that he was blind. We learned that he gave his eyes, I think, to the high table.
That's what he said, yeah.
Again, like you have these different assassins who essentially like their reputation precedes them wherever they go. They have been very effective, but at the same time, they all kind of have their own sacrifice that they've had to make over the years. And there's this kind of sense of regret with the choices that they had made when they were younger and how they are now put in these places of torture in a way, because not only was he blind, but then he also couldn't actually see and have a relationship with his daughter because there was some kind of arrangement made where as long as he stayed away from his daughter, that like the high table would allow him to retire out and not do the job. But then, you know, that's a big cost,
right,
that he had to take on. And so I just like that though, because I thought of Halle Berry's character about how she too had some kind of big sacrifice where like she, I think, had a daughter, perhaps with a son or a daughter, I can't remember, but she was, you know, grieving the fact that she had to stay so far. She was in a totally different part of the world in order to keep her kids safe. So like you have like these different assassins that clearly have some kind of leverage that the high table definitely uses.
Right.
Yeah. And has over them. But Donnie Yen, my goodness, like it was such a delight to watch him on screen do his thing. I totally bought in the fact that his character was blind. It was so cool how he was doing his thing. Can we just talk about the doorbells for a moment?
My wife was like, how many of those does he have? He was like five or 10.
I didn't know what they were at first. I was like, is that C4?
Like, this looks like explosive. Like, you better get out of there.
Like, yeah. Like what? Like the dude's blind. Like, what's he thinking? And then you see it happen. I'm like, that is brilliant.
Yeah.
So it was so simple, but at the same time, you're just like it went from thinking like, man, this guy's kind of in like a tight spot. And I wasn't necessarily rooting for him because I really was rooting for the Osaka Continental. But then you see that happening. I'm like, what on earth? And then you see it and you watch and you're like, oh, those guys are just toast.
Yeah. Well, I think he had to do that too, because he gave a lot of like Daredevil vibes to me. Because if you watch Daredevil, he can't see, or he can see very little. He can see, you have to see the show. Anyway, but his hearing is very, very good. Like he can hear your heartbeat for crying out loud.
Yeah.
And so I was thinking that with this, because he's definitely blind, but he has his cane. He's kind of tapping along, but he can hear exactly where you are. And therefore he has very good aim. Right? Yeah. That's what makes him
deadly.
I'm deadly. He's only more. He's just as deadly as John Wick.
Yeah.
And so, but in the kitchen scene, yeah, like people are firing, they're like stomping their feet, and so you have all this extra distracting stuff, and he came prepared with the little doorbell
thing. I think it's brilliant. I mean, again, like it really is a testament to how deadly his character is, because the whole time I'm thinking, what if he could actually see?
Yeah.
You know, like the blindness is an impairment to a certain extent, but he clearly can more than hold his own being blind. He would be even more deadly if he could see what the heck was going on. Another aspect of the character is I loved his trash talk. Mm-hmm. But it wasn't just him trash talking for the sake of trash talking. It was like his character had clearly been around for a long time working for the high table. He has history with people like John Wick. John Wick is a friend. There are other people that he knows, like even the manager at the Osaka Continental. So he's similar to John Wick, for instance, where like he does in fact have certain boundaries. Like he's not just out to kill for the sake of killing. Like there are certain professional courtesies. There are certain areas of respect. And there's also this acknowledgement that the fact that he is this death bringer, that he realizes how that impacts families and is this tragic talent that he does in fact have, which again, it really fleshes out his character, makes him much more deep. And I loved how when he was interacting with other types of villains, I mean, his quips and like his stuff, I mean, he, again, still staying with the style of speech, which is very to the point, only one or two words spoken. But I loved how it wasn't like he was like this mild mannered, quiet kind of guy or whatever. There were moments of that when like, you know, like when he was with John Wick in the church and they were having time together. But at the same time, like, I mean, he really was out and loud about like calling people names or telling them to F off or whatever, you know, like there was that side of him that I really thought was original in terms of his character. And again, it helps to kind of separate what makes John Wick unique versus what makes Kane unique and so on and so forth.
And I also say, my wife brought this up too, is something that she appreciates about the series is that they don't just use like men in black with guns all the time. So you have people who are like sumo, right? You have people who are giant, like the guy in the library from John Wick 2.
Yeah.
You have a guy that's blind, you have a girl that's mute.
Yep.
Right? So they're branching out into different areas where of uniqueness, I'll put it that way.
Well,
areas
of uniqueness. It's character building.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So anyway.
No, you're totally right. And that, again, that is one of the many strengths of the John Wick series is they don't just, like you said, they're not these like nameless nobodies in suits, except for Mr. Nobody, and he's not wearing a suit. But the fact that there are these very defined character traits that make them memorable, that make it so easy. And I love all of those encounters, not to mention the fact they all have their own personalities. Like the giant in the library, for example. You know, they knew each other already, and they're just like, oh, hey, John. He's like, I still have 10 minutes or something like that. Yeah. He's like, well, what's the point?
Who's counting?
Yeah. And he's like, are you sure you want to do this? He's like, that's a lot of money.
Yeah.
You know, like it was just so funny because there wasn't any kind of like hate or animosity toward each other. Again, it was just that whole sense of greed. And
can I just say one thing? In the John Wick,
say many things.
In the John Wick world, what I appreciate is that these assassins are going to face you before they kill you. Because
Mr. Nobody doesn't.
That is definitely true.
He comes in from behind you. He's in the shadows.
He does, but I mean, there was plenty of instances where like he could have capped John from a distance away. Oh, I see him walking and
okay, 40 million. But you remember why though? Because the amount wasn't high enough.
True. But in that could have happened anywhere in the entire John Wick world, right? But all the assassins want to like look at you and face you head on and best you. And
I think that's also part of, I think there's an allure among the assassins themselves, because I don't think they would do that with other contracts, right? I think in terms of like, for instance, like the Baba Yaga is this like world known assassin, right? And I do think some of these other prominent assassins, either because they know him or they respect him or they want the challenge of seeing if they can take him out, you have more of that kind of walking right into the light and saying, you know, I'm gonna try and kill you kind of thing. Because if you think of the other like unknown assassins, they were coming at him every which way. They were
sure.
Like, you know, there was a scene, I think it was from John Wick Chapter 3 at the beginning where he's been excommunicado and you know, he's going through the subway and there's that one woman who had the violin playing, and then like he walks by and then she tries to like take him out after he's already walked past. I mean, there are several instances like that where you have other types of assassins not be on the up and up in terms of just like getting into his line of sight and be like, I'm going to fight you now. So, I mean, again, it's just a healthy balance.
Yeah.
Oh, it's so good.
Yeah.
It is so good, Steve. So good.
You want to talk about the ending, Russ?
Let's talk about the ending, Steve. Why don't you go ahead?
Well, do you think John Wick is dead or do you not?
That is a good question. I think it's difficult to know, but I was surprised. Here's what I'm thinking.
What are you thinking?
I'm surprised. Well, let me back up a little bit.
Oh, okay.
I was surprised in the theater when the scene cut from him just laying on the steps of that gorgeous church to all of a sudden it's like, oh, now he's in the grave, like the tombstone. And you have both the manager and the Bowery King standing there and talking and that sort of thing. Although they did have kind of a little glint in their eye, like, you know, where do you think he is, heaven or hell? And, you know, who knows, that sort of thing.
Right.
I did think it was weird though, because as I was thinking about it, I'm like, okay, John's like, part of John's paradox is that he has to stay alive for as long as possible in order to remember the memory of his wife. But all he wants to do is die because life is meaningless without his wife.
Right.
So when you get to that scene, he's won. Like he's done his thing. Now he's been shot three times, but if you notice, none of those shots are fatal shots. Like, right. Kane purposely shot him in areas that would not likely shatter any bone. That would be exit wounds that were like, you know, one was up here, one was like in his love handle. You know, it wasn't like, oh, he got shot in the right. stomach, or oh, he got shot in the lung or the chest.
The eyeball, right.
Yeah. I mean, like, again, like those types of wounds. Now, if those wounds were to go untreated, he could bleed out, right? Mm-hmm. So I think that scene was put in as shock value, kind of like, oh my gosh, like there's a finality here. Like he's, it looks like he's gone. But at the same time, I'm thinking, is he really gone or is it more of something else? But see, like if he were to fake that, that's one thing. But at the same time, if he did fake it, then I'm pretty sure the Bowery King and, the manager would kind of know about it. Like, why would they still be visiting his site unless it's for optics, where like they want to make it look like, oh, you know, to anyone who's eavesdropping or spying or whatever. So I don't have a definitive answer one way or the other.
Yeah. I think they left the door open, mm-hmm. but I think we're supposed to believe he's dead for multiple reasons. Story, mm-hmm. like throughout the chapters, they're saying you can only be at peace if you're dead. He doesn't have anything to live for. His dog is dead. Well, he got another dog, but anyway, his original, the dog his wife gave him is dead. His wife is dead. His house is blown to smithereens. Never rebuilt his house. He doesn't get any money from any of this. And so his life is in shambles. He has nothing to live for. He's not happy throughout the entire show, movie, environment, world, whatever. And not to mention, outside the movie, Keanu, he's almost 60 years old, so he can't keep this up. And he said, like, I think I'm done with this. Like, not that he doesn't like the character, but I think it's, I mean, you see some of the behind-the-scenes stuff.
Oh, yeah.
These are long fight sequences. Yes. They're not chopped up into, like, you know, a second and a half here, 3 seconds here. These are long, drawn-out, choreographed fight sequences.
I think Keanu Reeves is, what, 58 years old?
58.
Yeah.
I looked last night. Anyway.
That's good.
So he said he's pretty much done. That being said, where there's money to be made and a story to be told and a good story to continue, I think, you know, he might be back or not. But IMDb says there's a chapter 5. Mm-hmm. When there was an interview with the director and he was like, yeah, we were writing chapter 5 with chapter 4 and we could have made two movies that were pretty good, or we can make one great one.
Yeah.
And so they went with one great one, which is why it was kind of long.
I did read an article about how the director said that they were going to take a break for a while from John Wick after John Wick 4. So that to me doesn't necessarily mean that they're not going to come back to John Wick. at the same time, I totally agree with what you're talking about. I mean, John Wick is 58. Keanu Reeves is 58 years old. And so that's just, you know, one of the unfortunate byproducts of age is that you're just, your physical prowess begins to diminish. And it has been, here's the thing, both Keanu Reeves and Tom Cruise are pretty close in age. And it is, they're both just, they're animals. Like they both are doing their own stunts and their own combat work and stuff in the movies that they make, whether it's Mission Impossible or it's John Wick. And it is, it's just, I mean, even Top Gun Maverick. I mean, you have a guy, Tom Cruise, I think is between 58 to 60 years old. I mean, I think he's right around there.
Yeah.
He was flying in those jets. Like all that stuff was legit. And so like, I mean, there's massive amounts of respect and admiration for me to see these older gentlemen be able to like take on these things because they know that brings a huge level of authenticity to the characters they're playing. Well, where like they don't have digital doubles, they don't have any kind of stunt doubles or anything like that. And so that puts us as the viewers even more at the edge of our seat because we're like, man, like that's really Keanu Reeves doing those moves.
Or I mean, even in Mission Impossible, I mean, he's jumping off of buildings and he's doing all his own stunts.
Yeah, he broke his ankle on one of the moves.
Yeah. Jackie Chan, Tom Cruise, Keanu Reeves.
Yeah.
Who else?
But I do think that is one of the problems or issues is that the older they get, then the harder it is. I mean, we have Harrison Ford who's reprising his role as Indiana Jones and
he's close to 90. I think.
No, he's not 90. I think he's 80.
Okay, well, 80.
He's 100 years old.
102. And he's still going.
He himself has become the artifact that other people are trying to get.
Oh, man.
But no, I do think that it is going to be interesting to see what happens. If they decide to not move forward with Keanu Reeves in terms of future John Wick films or just that world itself, I think they have done such a superb job in building this world. And I've talked about this in previous reviews that we've done for John Wick Chapter 2 and Chapter 3. The fact that they have approached it the way they have, there's just a wealth of history. There's a wealth of how the high table works and how this underground assassins community functions. And it's ripe to be able to perhaps showcase other types of assassins that live in this world. I do think it's going to be a challenge because John Wick as a character is the OG of this world.
Right.
So no one can replace John Wick and nor should they. But at the same time, I know that if they were to pick the right people, and again, the director and the crew behind this have been perfect in their casting. Like you look at all these different actors they've chosen and the characters that they have created for these actors to play. There's no, at least up until this point, there is no inkling of a drought of how they can make these characters. Because honestly, there are a lot of those previous characters they've made that I would love to see multiple movies made of just their journey, their encounters, you know, like what they have to deal with. And on top of that, what's really cool is like you could still have Keanu Reeves make cameo appearances in those types of situations. So I don't know, like I go back and forth because it's like, well, there's that, or the other option would be like, for instance, like the digital double, like where like, you know, for all the actual fighting combat sequences, they would use somebody else. I do think there would be something lost in terms of that, knowing that that's not actually Keanu anymore.
Right. Yeah.
So I'm conflicted. I don't know.
Let me ask you about the duel sequence, though.
Yes.
So throughout the movie, we're told to believe that the Marquis is such a bad guy. And he's a bad guy. But you almost, or at least I was wondering, how did this guy get appointed to the high table if we don't see him back it up? You know, because he's increasing the reward or the bounty, if you would say, against John Wick. Got it. Okay, he stabs nobody in the hand, so he wants to, you know, test his commitment.
His loyalty.
Loyalty.
Yeah.
Okay, so there's that. And, you know, he shoots what's-his-face in the beginning movie, which I thought sucked, because I wanted to see him more throughout the movie, honestly.
Yeah.
I think that, I don't, you know, the actor passed away.
Yeah. Lance.
From
Lance Riddick.
Natural causes, but we don't know what that was. I'm just wondering if he was sick for a while, which is why they took him out so early in the film. They had to write that in. But I really wanted to see him throughout the whole thing. He just brought it just a different level of polish.
He was one of the pillars that make up the world of John Wick.
Yeah, I did. So if he wasn't sick and they just decided to take him out so early, that's an issue. But we don't know. Mm-hmm. I was happy to see him either way. If they wasn't there at all, it would have been something is definitely missing from the... Anyway, so the marquee.
Mm-hmm. Another one of Steve's digressions.
I can't help it. His thoughts are flowing everywhere. So at the end of the movie, you know, I understood, okay, you know, they're going to have him fight his friend and, you know, because he's ruthless and whatever. And I get that, but I just didn't see... I kind of wanted there to be more of a face-off between John and the marquee. Did you feel the same way?
I think in terms of the people, like the various villains that we have seen in the John Wick films who are at that level or close to that level, they are far more political in nature. They're not necessarily someone who is adept at the gun fu as some of these other characters or assassins or whatever. It's with limited knowledge of the High Table. They've been very... very successful at just doling out information over the various movies where they don't just say, okay, this is what it's about. Let me put it to you this way. John Wick doesn't have one of those scenes where, Master Jedi, I've been wondering, what are midichlorians?
Well, Annie, let me tell you all about it.
Like, they don't have any of that. Instead, they are very practical with like, okay, we're going to give them this little chunk of a nugget of information that then they, you know, the fans can chew on a bit and then we'll expand upon that in the next film and so forth. And so even after John Wick Chapter 4, we still don't have like this huge hierarchy or, you know, flow chart of like, okay, this person's here and this person's, and then they have this and, you know, we don't have any of that. But that's part of the mystique of the world that is John Wick. I like the mystique. Right. I like not knowing everything. But, you know, you see some of these characters such as the brother from, I believe it was John Wick Chapter 2, where he, you know, for political purposes, you know, he wants to have the seat instead of his sister. And his sister got the seat because I think their father passed away or something. I'm a little hazy on like how she came into it. But like basically my understanding of how the High Table works and those like kind of the lieutenants of the High Table, so to speak, is it's kind of like this game of chess when it comes to like the underworld politics and how much favor do you have? How much influence do you have? There's a lot of positioning. It's almost like their version of Game of Thrones, where those types of people don't have necessarily the physical prowess to hold their own, but they can manipulate situations and get other people to be their proxy to fight. Just like what we saw here, where like the Marquis, you know, finagled and used, you know, basically took advantage of a loophole to force Kane to be his proxy to fight John Wick, because the Marquis ultimately is this arrogant coward.
Right.
But he's still, he's very vain, arrogant, like I said earlier, diabolical, evil. There are all kinds of traits to it, but you know, it's like a video game, Steve. Like, you know, you always get introduced to the main baddie, but then you can't just take him out right then and there. No, you got to go through all his cronies. And finally, when you corner him,
then you find out he's on steroids and he breathes fire and like has magic. Like, what the heck? What in the world?
Yeah, yeah. You're just like, how is that?
Oh, laser beams out of his eyes.
You ripped your clothes off.
Let's go. You're
like, man, now I know why he's so evil.
It does make me, you know, what's really funny is that a lot of those old school video games where like you come across the last boss and they have some sort of huge transformation.
Some big robot.
It does kind of subconsciously make me think about the actual workforce, the workplace, right? You know, you go to your day job and you're like, you know, if I were to corner my boss, like, would he also like have some sort of crazy transformation and completely scare me to death? And have some, he looks like he has the body of like an overweight 50-year-old, but, tear off that white collared shirt and suddenly he's got like this like six pack and
he's got prison body.
He like can lift up desks with one hand. And like,
you want to go? Okay. I'll work on Sunday. Got it.
That's so funny. So good. Well, Did you have any other scenes or comments that you want to make, or should we go into our final thoughts and rating?
Final thoughts and verdicts, Russ.
Take it away, Steve.
So this was probably, I would say, the movie of so far of the year. This is ranking on top of my list so far, Russ. A lot of the movies have a high bar to compare to. It deserves a lot of awards, and I want to see the cast and the behind the scenes folks. I want to see them receive their awards. I don't watch the Academy and the Oscars and stuff, but if this is nominated, and it should, I'm tuning in.
Can you imagine if it actually got nominated Best Picture? Like that, I would not believe my eyes and ears if I saw the Academy nominate John Wick Chapter 4 for Best Picture.
Dude, I've been out of it so long. Do they even have like a best like action movie? Or is that more of like an MTV award kind
of
thing?
Yeah, I think it's probably more like, yeah, MTV award or People's Choice Awards or something like that. Which honestly, that is much more fun in my opinion than some of the stuff they have at the Oscars. But that's just one man's opinion.
Anyhow, this is, the series as a whole clearly stands out. I was coming into this thinking, do I like The Matrix more or John Wick more?
Yeah.
And I definitely like John Wick more. I think if I was to compare The Matrix 1 and John Wick 1, I'd probably choose The Matrix 1 better. But The Matrix as a whole doesn't compare to John Wick, all four chapters. They're crazy well done.
Yeah.
And definitely worth seeing in the theater, definitely worth picking up for your movie collection. I had a list of gripes that do take away a little bit from the score. Not a lot, but it definitely takes away. I felt like, again, if they wanted me to feel exhaustion with the fighting, I definitely felt exhausted.
Well, when you said score, you don't mean the music.
My score.
Your film score. Gotcha.
Because the score of the movie is fine. I know.
No qualms. I figured I'd clarify. I'm like, what?
I mean, I did feel somewhat exhausted at the end of it, and I did feel like some of the fighting was a bit repetitive. It wasn't bad. I'm not trying to give that. I just thought I wanted it to be more special. Maybe with Mr. Nobody, it could have been that extra layer of like just frosting on top. I didn't feel like he really added anything to the story. I wanted him to be more unique than he was. Even if it feels like he was... if you used quick draw a lot more, because no one uses quick draw in John Wick, and he did that like once, I'm like, yeah, that's cool. And then he never did it ever again.
Yeah.
I wanted to see him use more abilities. I wanted to see his story fleshed out. I wanted to see him be more unique. And I just didn't feel like they really drew out his character as much as they could within the final movie, if this is the final movie, of the series. I wanted to see them draw more from the characters that we've seen in previous chapters. Even if they had a little bit of screen time, I wanted them to do that, and they didn't. I don't know. Overall, I had an awesome time. There were just little sequences like that that would have set it over the top. Still incredible. I had an awesome time in the theater, and I can't wait to pick up the movie. But because of my, just like the gripe, little pebbles of sand, if you will, in the hourglass, Russ, I'm going to say it's a 4.5.
A 4.5.
I wanted to give it a 5, and John Wick 1 is definitely a 5. I didn't like it as much as John Wick 1. I liked it better than the third, about the same as the second, maybe a little bit better than the second, which is a feat in itself. I mean, the fourth movie, I don't see how it could even compare. And this one definitely closely compares to number one. So it goes well for all the behind the scenes movie making, this script, the cast, I mean, everything.
Yeah.
But to me, it just doesn't get that 5-star quite yet.
Fair enough. No. For me, this is the kind of film, it's why I go to the movie theater. You know, what was funny was that I actually had to reschedule myself. I was going to see it on like the largest screen that the local theater had. It's like an XD theater. But unfortunately, when I looked, I realized, oh my goodness, like I have other stuff I got to do like that is going to run into the 2 hours and 47 minutes or whatever it was. So I had to actually reschedule and watch it on a smaller screen, which it was still fine. But like, I still want that big screen experience. And looking at what they did, I totally agree. I had the same thought as you did with regards to The Matrix, where the original Matrix movie was this completely original story. And the characters were fantastic. You could tell they're having a good time. But then the subsequent sequels afterwards were not nearly as good. Like, right. There were like little like pockets of brilliance and that sort of thing. But overall, it started kind of getting lost in its own philosophies and its approach to things. And so he was just like, if you look at Matrix 1, 2, and 3, clearly the first Matrix was head and shoulders the best. And I totally agree with what you were talking about with John Wick, about how John Wick doesn't have that problem. It continues to be just as good, if not better, than the previous films. And you know, that's a subjective opinion. We all have our own personal favorite John Wick film out of the four that's been produced so far. But it is such an achievement for the cast and crew to be able to put forth what they have done over the last 9 years. It's crazy to think about how much time has gone by in that time period. But I think every one of them should be very proud of the fact that they have that on their resume, that they created and worked on the John Wick franchise. I think this type of story is like in line with like what J.K. Rowling has done with the Harry Potter franchise, where you have the world building, you have these memorable characters, these memorable villains, you have these fantastic vistas. There's always this element of mystery and surprise. It's just ripe to be able to expand more and more and more and have these offshoots, which apparently there are a couple of TV shows that they are working on. I really hope that they are just as fantastic as what we've seen here. And I think that's a very high bar to achieve. And I think, you know, Keanu as an actor, and especially as an action actor, you know, he's done a lot of other action movies in addition to The Matrix and John Wick. And it's such a pleasure to see him, having grown up as kids, seeing his entire career flourish and do what he does. And so seeing something like this is, I wouldn't necessarily say it's like his personal magnum opus, but at the same time, I just love how when they decided to do this particular movie, they were like, we're going to shoot for 3-hour film. That's action movie. We're going to have all kinds of places we're going to go. All the different fighting sequences, when you think about the different types of weaponry that was used or hand-to-hand combat, that sort of thing, were just phenomenal. I don't know, like there was this is lightning caught in a bottle. Like, and this is something that I preach about all the time, is that as a creative, and for me, like I work, as you know, in the video game industry, but it's the same kind of premise where it's like, it's very difficult to capture that special lightning. And it's also very difficult to keep it in the bottle, because you can easily lose it just as quick as you caught it. And for these past four films, they have been able to, they first caught the lightning in a bottle and they were able to hold on to it all this time. And that is a very rare thing. That's a very special thing in terms of how you just don't see that happen hardly at all. And you know, we've also noticed how like there have been other franchises that, you know, once had the lightning in the bottle, but then very obviously have lost it.
But the power went out.
The power went out?
And so the lightning.
Yeah. Anyway, I could just gush about this movie. I mean, I could gush about the series as well for hours and hours and hours. But for me, this is an easy 5-star film. This is a film I cannot highly recommend enough. I feel like if this were to be the last John Wick movie, what a way to go out. What? I mean, I just, even like, you know, and we kind of touched upon it in the overall review, but I love even the choice of job titles that exist in John Wick. You know, the Harbinger. That is so cool. And not only that, but like even the function of that role is so cool. The actor they got to hire for that is, he nailed it. You know, you think of the adjudicator. I mean, like, We never use these words in day-to-day
I want that life. On my business card.
Yeah.
Who are you?
Yeah. You know, and like even something like the manager, they take a job title that is used in day-to-day life. It's yeah, it's very mundane, very boring. And but then you put it in John Wick's world and you're like, the manager, you know, or the concierge. Like they take these different types of job titles or words and turn them into these very cool, distinguishable sounding names. I don't know. And that's part of their magic too, is they're able to take like, it's so hard to describe, but they've been able to take these different types of attributes that I think both conscious and subconsciously as people, like we kind of like, we always like the nice suit. We like the exotic car. We like, you know, how these characters are being treated in the films. We wish we were treated that same way wherever we went, right? We like the clout. You know, the element of danger, but being able to hold our own. We love all the different types of weapons that are being shown. And again, they're being shown like fine wines. You know, oh, this one was 1978. You know, going through the whole thing. That taps into, I think, a certain level of humanity's psyche that we have a very positive response to.
Can I just say one more thing?
You sure can,
Steve. As a final thought. I'm not sure if I'm glad or I miss the sequence where he picks up his weapons. Like he did it in John Wick 1 and 2. He like went to Italy and they're talking about food and steak and dinner and dessert and stuff. And it would be, I'm kind of glad they didn't do it because it would have been rehashed yet again, like the fourth time of it. But I kind of miss it because that scene was so cool where he goes like, or if it was, he'd be riding the Osaka and he goes, oh, this is your sake for tonight. And it's like some Bushido blade sort of thing. And here's your Kobe beef or so, you know, all these different very high class Japanese entrees, right? But it's all different weapons. I don't know if I really want it there or I'm glad they didn't rehash it again. I'm like 50-50 with it.
I do think if they did do it, you don't have to limit it to just food or dinner courses, right? Like, again, like the wine, for instance, like, you know, vintage, you know, 1926, you know, that sort of thing. I think there are multiple subjects or multiple approaches that you could have in that regard, because I love that, because again, it reinforces this level of sophistication. They're not just these, like, I don't know, average Joe killer, whatever, like they conduct themselves on this totally other level. And you know, that's part of the fantasy, right? That's part of the entertainment. So I can't highly recommend it enough. The only people I would say is like, if you're squeamish, if you're not into like, you know, gung fu movies, fighting blood, that sort of thing, then this may not be for you. But for those who enjoy action movies like this, this is a crowning achievement for the action movie franchise. So there you have it. That wraps up this episode of Joygasm. We thank you so much for hanging out with us. If you enjoy this episode, we invite you to check out patreon.com/joygasm, which is spelled JOYGASM, and consider becoming a monthly contributor. You'll gain exclusive perks as well as early access to the show, not to mention the fact that it helps us financially continue doing the podcast. Also, click on that subscribe button, as well as that notification bell. That way you will not miss a single solitary episode of Joygasm that drops once a week each week. And last but not... Oh, actually, I should say, while you're at it, you could do a search for @JoygasmTV on your favorite social media platform of choice. And last but not least, do a search for Joygasm TV on Twitch to see us stream our gaming adventures live every Wednesday night at 9:30 p.m. Central Time. We thank you for hanging out with us, and we look forward to you reconvening next week when we talk about Octopath Traveler 2. We'll see you then.